Hey everyone, it's Dr. Namani and Dr. Louie back again today here at The Athlete Spine, and we're really excited to have Dr. Baron Lonner here with us today, who is an expert in vertebral body tethering, which is a topic that we touched on last week in our video with one of his patients, Maria Canias, the volleyball player. Dr. Lonner is the chief of minimally invasive scoliosis surgery and pediatric spine at Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City. So thanks so much, Dr. Lonner, for joining us.
Well, great to be with you both, Dr. Namani and Dr. Louis. I'm glad to have the opportunity to speak about this.
Topic. And this is a fun topic for us because we've talked about this population before, right? This adolescent preteen population that have scoliosis, but our conversations have really been based on two separate treatments. One is everything non-surgical with bracing and essentially physical therapy and observation. And then the longer fusions, and we've highlighted some athletes before that have undergone the longer fusions and have gone back to play, as well as some surgeons who've talked about it. But our topic today is really looking at a very different surgery for scoliosis, and that's one that allows for growth to continue to occur, and it modulates growth as well as sort of motion preservation. Tell us a little bit about that, actually.
Well, it's a great introduction. You know, I just for the audience would say that I've been practicing, this is my third decade of practice, almost 30 years. And most of our patients with scoliosis, pretty common, about 3% of the population has idiopathic scoliosis in the adolescent years. And most of them don't need surgery. But then there's a subset, about 10%, that will require surgery. And of those patients, you know, I've done more than 2,000 spinal fusions. That's been the standard approach and the standard of care. And it works very well. It corrects the scoliosis. It allows the patients to get back to their activities. But the problem with spine fusion is it stiffens the spine. So the levels of the spine that are fused and instrumented, corrected, don't move any longer. So these tend to be long fusions, and they can extend into the lumbar spine where most of our mobility is. And over the years, that can have an impact on function, on ability to play sports, and later it can cause wear and tear or disc degeneration below the fusion. So now in comes vertebral body tethering or non-fusion scoliosis correction, which really came out of a lot of research over the last 20 years. And the first case was done about 15 years ago, but the vast majority of these operations really have been done over the last 3 to 5 years worldwide. And so I've been fortunate in my practice to do a lot of these operations. And it's a revolutionary change in how we treat patients. It's wonderful and exciting for me as a surgeon, but it's such a special option for the right patient that's carefully selected. Because as you said, it allows growth, it allows motion. The hope is that there'll be less problems below a tether than there will be below a fusion over the years, especially with fusions in the lumbar spine. So I think there's a lot of excitement around it. We're learning a lot, and we're honing down on the best patients for this operation, who does the best with this procedure and who we can offer this to. And I think the one other point before we go on is, the patient's recovery is a lot faster than after a spinal fusion. There's less bleeding with the surgery. There's very, very minimal infection risk. Patients get back to their sport. In my practice, by 6 weeks, we start getting them back to sport, and they have less pain than the standard fusion.
That's great. And, you know, we may actually have, you know, some teenagers and adolescents who are watching, you know, this podcast, you know, and wonder what kind of patient or what kind of scoliosis or curvature might be, you know, a candidate for tethering versus a fusion. And you mentioned kind of tethering in the lumbar spine versus the thoracic spine. Are there different kind of indications or when you might tether those types of curves or size of curve? You know, does that make a difference?
Yes, it does, because the largest of curves, the most severe curves, it's very difficult to tether those. We won't get enough correction for the patient, and then they won't have a good long-term outcome. Now, Sometimes a patient presents with a very severe thoracic curve, the rib portion of the spine, upper spine, and we'll do a fusion there. But because they have a large curve below, and we would like to avoid fusing the lumbar spine, then we can do a hybrid where we do a tether below. But I think the best ideal patient has a not the most severe curve, so curves up to 65, maybe 70 degrees that are flexible. They, when they do a bending x-ray, they correct to 30 degrees or so or less. And I really like this for lumbar curves because, again, that's where our flexibility is. And for young people who are dancers or into sport, like I know a patient you're going to be highlighting on your podcast, one of my patients, many of the patients are very athletic and they want their flexibility. So the lumbar spine is really the I think, the most compelling area to address. But there are lots of patients who are, let's say, a swimmer. They do a lot of flip turns. They may be a backstroker or a butterflyer. And they like the flexibility even in their thoracic spine. Rock climbers, people who climb, they arch their upper back, people who do yoga. So they also benefit from a tether in the thoracic area. So I think it plays a role throughout both the thoracic and lumbar spine, curves that are not too large and that are nice and flexible, and in a patient who has enough growth to allow growth modulation. So those are the ideal indications. We sometimes push the envelope a little in very select cases, but those are the, I think, the ideal patients.
Yeah, and you brought up something that certainly piqued my interest earlier on when you were talking about, you know, a lot of your patients, especially that age, are athletes in one way or another, and obviously that's been the focus of our podcast in general. But you said a lot of these patients you allow to go back to play around 6 weeks. Can you compare the recovery between your fusion patients and your tether patients in terms of there's like protocol of returning back to play and why you allow the tether patients to go back so much earlier than the fusion patients?
For sure. Great question. And it's really important to the patients and the families. They ask about recovery and how quickly they can get back, especially with the athletes that you're dealing and talking to every week. There's really a great desire to get back training, competing. And our techniques have evolved a lot over my career and before. When we were doing fusions early on, we didn't use screws into the spine, we used hooks, and the patients took longer time to heal. I did a lot of those cases early on. And so we'd hold patients back for a full year from full activity. Mm-hmm. We might get them into some activities at 6 months, but it was literally a full year and their bodies were deconditioned. And a lot of times they didn't get back to their sport. More recent years, we've gotten our fusion patients back at about 3 months. And now we're using screws and we get really powerful corrections and stable implants. But when you do a fusion, you move the muscles aside. It's part of the dissection for performing the operation. And then we put the implants in. And so it's very painful. It deconditions the muscles. And then we start to get them back with physical therapy and starting their sport beginning around 3 months, but they're really not up and running for another, you know, at least 6 to 8 weeks following that. As opposed to the tether patients, I really encourage patients to get in the swimming pool at 3 or so weeks, walking and doing kickboard. I also tell the fusion patients to do that, although I don't allow them to do kickboard. But kickboard allows them to get their core going starting at three weeks. And then at 6 weeks, we start physical therapy. I've had all the families have my personal phone number. So I get videos of young people back in their sport or dancing a little before 6 weeks, even sometimes. I had one of my patients about 5 years ago. She was playing tennis, didn't look like she had surgery. And that was at 5 weeks. So, but we start usually at 6 weeks. We get them in to physical therapy and some are really up and running pretty quickly. So I don't restrict them. Other surgeons do. They put them in a brace or they go a little slower, but I've not seen any problems with loosening of screws or breaking of the tether by letting the patients get going sooner. And I think it helps them recover from the surgery and get their strength back much quicker by getting them on their feet and running.
Yeah, I mean, you brought up kind of a very interesting point that, you know, because of some of the restrictions that we put on people because of our operations, whether that's a microdiscectomy and we want them to kind of limit their lifting or bending or twisting for the first, you know, maybe a couple of weeks just to try to prevent a reherniation, or an effusion patient to, again, limit bending, lifting, twisting, because we want the implants to hold and not to loosen that early period. That in and of itself can kind of decondition people. They can become stiffer or less flexible. And so it sounds like you don't really put any restrictions at all on your patients after a tether and kind of let them go back to doing everything as soon as they're able to.
Well, Dr. Namati, sort of true, but I do tell them no BLT, bending, lifting, twisting for about 6 weeks. Even though I get them in the swimming pool and they can do some kickboard, they're still kind of limiting it, but they're not fragile. They don't loosen. I have never seen a screw loosen by getting them back in a more rapid time frame. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they have less pain as well. So often they're off medications by a week after surgery, 10 days or so. And fusion patients often need medication for longer. So I think it's all of those things, getting them back sooner, avoids the deconditioning, having less pain, and not holding them back too much, I really think helps.
Yeah, and you mentioned that tethering is obviously relatively new compared to the gold standard of fusion, right? You know, we're looking at 15-ish years, and, you know, we're predominantly adult surgeons. And what we face is sort of the same discussion between cervical disc replacements and ACDFs and fusions, where, you know, you'd say our data is now 12 to 15 years. What are you telling your patients, and especially the patient's family and their parents, when they're asking you, how long has this been out and what does the data show? What can we expect long-term? Because these patients are young and they have so much of life to live in front of them. Right. And they're really active.
It's a great question, because when I first started thinking about bringing this technique into my practice, you know, 25 years ago, I was performing thoracoscopic minimally invasive technique fusions of the thoracic spine, but fusions. So similar technique to what we're doing today, but we used a solid metal rod and we fused the spine. And so we've always been thinking about this, and I had this skill set. So it was sort of, I was the right surgeon to offer my patients tethering, but I was afraid it was all going to fall apart and I didn't really trust it initially. So I held back a little bit. And so now when I talk to patients and families, we spend a lot of time. And, you know, with my experience with fusion and continue to perform fusion operations, I think it gives me a perspective. I also see the long-term outcomes of these long fusions in patients. Some of them have pain. Some of them have restrictions in their activities. And the thought is maybe that will be better long-term after a tether. But as I tell the families, we don't have long-term data. It's a new procedure. My earliest patients were done 10 years ago, or just under 10 years ago. So time will tell. But what we don't do is we don't burn any bridges. We haven't permanently altered the spine. There are the screws there and the tether, but we haven't cut the discs. We haven't taken the joints out. We haven't eliminated motions. We haven't created a solid bony fusion. We allow them to continue and live their lives and have as normal a spine as possible. We do tell them, you know, with a lot of growth, the curve can overcorrect in the opposite direction, because we harness growth and use that to get further correction after the initial surgery. So if we don't time it right, and we've learned a lot about which curves are best, if you take on a patient with a very small curve and a lot of growth, they're likely to overcorrect. So we may hold back a little bit on that patient. So we want to avoid overcorrection. And then long-term, especially with all these athletic patients that we have, the tether can break. It's likely to break. But as I tell them, it's not a catastrophe. Your child doesn't go flying. It's not a slingshot. They don't hear the break. They don't hear the break. They don't feel the break. Maybe they could have some muscle discomfort, but we don't know if that was from a tether breaking or just they had muscle discomfort. Usually it'll break at one segment, so the rest of it holds. It could break at multiple segments over time, but also the tether doesn't move around the body. It doesn't migrate. It stays put. So mm-hmm. if the tether breaks, that doesn't mean the curve is fully recurred or that they need another surgery. Most of the time, we're just observing the patients. But in the event in 10, 15, 20 years, or who knows, in a long life, in the event the curve comes back, or there's a problem of the spine, like a disc herniation, and you gentlemen do these operations every day, or other problem of the spine, that can still be addressed with a fusion later on. And our other thought is for patients that have their curve recur, but they otherwise have a healthy spine, we're going to have stronger tethers in the future. So, and the engineers tell us they could be as much as 4 times stronger.
Wow.
So sometimes we'll double up the row of tethers. So we'll have 2 rows in the lumbar spine because there's a lot of force on those tethers. In the future, we could potentially replace broken tethers by putting in these new stronger ones if the patient had their curve come back and recur. And so then that likely would take them many years down the line and perhaps throughout for their the rest of their life. So potentially we could avoid a fusion even if there's a need to go back in. So far, the patients are doing well and we have a pretty low reoperation rate. I don't think that was true early on, and that's kind of why I held back, because I think the early surgeons doing this learned a lot, and that was part of the learning curve. So I think we were very careful about exactly when to indicate the surgery, and by doing so, we lower the reoperation rate.
Yeah, well, it sounds like there's a lot of, you know, potential advancements in technology that are going to be coming that you know, could bring this up, make the operation even safer, and potentially increase the number of, children and adolescents that potentially are candidates for this sort of procedure. You know, one fascinating thing that you kind of alluded to is that it doesn't sound like there's really a sport which is a contraindication to a patient having a tether, which is a little different than, you know, we had a recent discussion with Dr. Rob Watkins. We discussed whether cervical disc replacements could be done in professional American football players. And, you know, the answer, I think, from him, who's probably operate on, you know, many professional football players, is an emphatic no. Whereas here in this case, it sounds like a tether really could be done in an athlete in any kind of sport.
Even football, I certainly agree. I wouldn't want a patient who had a disc replacement to go into playing pro football. But so I often get asked by patients, you know, what things should I avoid too, or what sports should I avoid so as not to break my tether? And I said, well, part of the purpose of having the tether is so that you can live your life to the fullest and participate in your sport. So I generally counsel them to do what they love to do and what they're passionate about. On the other hand, if they really want to protect their tether, they may stay away from some sports like gymnastics or cheerleading, where there's a lot of tumbling, or even swimming, where you're doing flip turns. But most of the patients don't do that. They pursue their sport to the fullest. I have swimmers, many swimmers. I have gymnasts, cheerleaders, soccer players, lacrosse, field hockey, golf, baseball, tennis, rowing, you know, crew. What's the other one? Rhythmic gymnastics, and really some high level athletes. Yeah. There's one that I'm missing. Oh, volleyball, plenty of volleyball players. So, and weightlifters. And I actually have the first football player I operated on was about 6 months ago. Mm-hmm. And he's a wide receiver. He's apparently very good. And he intends on going back. And we've encouraged him to do that. So I think even if the tether breaks, as I said, it's not a catastrophe. They still have their spine. It's stable. And so they can keep playing. So we don't limit it.
Yeah, that's great. I mean, and that's the beauty of medicine in general, is that we are always sort of learning from what we've been doing so that we can do things better in the future. And I know you're very active on the research front as well. And we look forward to sort of seeing how this technique will continue to progress over time, because we're seeing patients that are just way more active than what they used to be. And their expectations are so much more than I think the expectations from even a decade or two ago. But you know, Dr. Lonner, thank you so much for joining us today. This is such a fun topic. And thank you for sharing your patient with us as well. And it's always such a fun discussion and diving into topics that we just don't talk about as much and aren't as mainstream as some of the other surgeries and spine problems that we hear about. So,
well, congratulations to you both for bringing to light the role of spine surgery in patients' lives and how they can continue to participate in sport and and live a full life. I think it's a terrific podcast, and I thank you for having me on with you gentlemen.
We really appreciate it. So everyone, thanks again for joining us. Be sure to like and subscribe and follow us on Instagram. Till next time, take care, everyone. Thanks again, Dr. Lonner.
Bye.